Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel. Today we'll be discussing on one of the very interesting topic which you will come across in your everyday practice almost every day. We call as a dizziness, and we'll be focusing more on vertigo, and we'll be dividing into two big groups: dizziness due to vertigo and non-vertigo conditions. Dizziness is a broad term, and it just means that it makes your head spin, that's all. But dizziness, the commonest condition which includes in dizziness is vertigo. Person feels as if everything is rotating around him, or he is rotating in the surrounding. So vertigo is not a diagnosis, it is a symptom from which you will have to find out whether it is a vertigo or it is a non-vertigo dizziness. So person feels like this. Again, you can see that person is feeling that as if he is spinning. There are few words which are very commonly utilized as far as dizziness is concerned. That is feeling fainting attacks, lightheaded, feeling weak, and most important, unsteady or rotating feeling or a spinning feeling. These are some of the descriptions. There are many more descriptions which we'll be showing you in the next slide. The commonest cause of dizziness is true vertigo, or we call vertigo, which is accounting for almost 50%. There's another symptom which mimics like vertigo, that is called disequilibrium, that is ataxia, which is accounting for only 2% of the dizziness group. And this will be particularly while he is walking or when he is standing. There is another group where the person feels that he will faint, he will become unconscious, he gets blackouts, that is we call syncope, and that is accounting for nearly 25% of the group. And there is another group we call as a person who complains of light headache. In that, maybe because of some drugs, or the most common cause for that is we call psychogenic. So you can see that out of all this group, the most common is true vertigo, second common is syncope and allied disorders, and third what we call is a psychogenic and drug induced. There are a few of the common words which are utilized: light headache, blackouts, giddiness, numbness, fainting episodes, confusion, claustrophobia, syncope, imbalance. Some person describes as out of it, sense of strangeness, etc. So we'll have to take a good history and try to identify it belongs to which. Again repeating, 50% are because of vertigo, 2% are because of ataxia, 25% are presyncope groups, and another 25%, of which 15% is psychiatric groups and 10% is idiopathic, or we call it a drug induced. Vertigo is a neurological symptoms, maybe peripheral or maybe central. Presyncope, ataxia is the other groups, of which the presyncope is non-neurological, while ataxia, or we call disequilibrium, is always neurological. Lightheaded does not belong to any groups, mainly it is psychological. Vertigo is a spinning sensation, presyncope is impending faintness, disequilibrium is unsteadiness of off balance, we commonly describe as, and other difficult to describe, and they are vague symptoms. Usually person complains of floating sensation, lightheaded, etc. The symptom does not fit with anything. The two different terms, vertigo and dizziness. Vertigo is a specific term, while dizziness is a broad term. Vertigo includes only vertigo, while dizziness includes vertigo, syncope, ataxia, or psychogenic, idiopathic, etc. Dizziness at any age, while vertigo is very common in elderly groups. Disequilibrium means person finds instability in an erect posture. And usually person will complain of imbalance. And vertigo may be present, may not be present. Because in a vestibular ataxia, vertigo will be present. Pre-syncope is person will say that I am going to faint or I am nearly fainting or blackouts. Very common, orthostatic hypotension, cardiac arrhythmia, vasovagal, sensitive carotid sinus, or maybe even because of what we call as structural heart disease like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, etc. The person feels impending fainting episodes, which is lasting for seconds to minutes. And it is a temporary phenomena because of lack of perfusion to the brain. Maybe associated with sweating, pallor, or maybe disturbances in level of consciousness. So the person will have a dipical episodes. We already described this particular part. While in a syncope, person becomes unconscious. It is for temporary period. It is a sudden onset. It is self-terminating. The person gets a full recovery. There is no postictal phase. And person recovers fully without any medical or surgical intervention. And this is because of lack of perfusion to the brain. And mainly it is triggered by a fall in systemic blood pressure. Psychogenic is a condition where the person is not able to describe the clinical symptoms and signs properly. It does not fit with either vertigo or with presyncope. By and large, it is a chronic. There is no focal findings. Very common mechanism is hyperventilation or maybe associated with psychological disorders like depressions, substance abuse, somatization, etc. So basically we divide into two big groups, pseudo-vertigo and true vertigo. True vertigo we divide into two, central and peripheral. While non-vertigo dizziness or we call pseudo-vertigo can be cardiac, can be because of orthostatic hypotension, metabolic disorders or hematological like anemia, hyperviscosity syndrome, etc. Or maybe because of drugs, maybe alcohol, anticonvulsant drug, antiarrhythmic drug, antidepressant, antihistaminics, antihypertensive, etc. And this will give rise to a big group we call the pseudo-vertigo. By and large, when we say vertigo, it is a subjective sense of imbalance where person feels as if external world is revolving around him or he himself is revolving in the space. We call subjective or an objective rotational feeling. So it is basically an illusion of a motion of self-movement or environmental movement. And person will say that he is getting spinning sensation as if he will fall or there is a swaying back to and fro or merry-go-round effects. And that is typically described as vertigo. The person feels as if he is rotating or surrounding is rotating. It is a typical illusion and may be associated with nausea, vomiting, diaphoresis. Good number of time it is associated with disequilibrium or we call ataxia. And together it is called as a vestibular ataxia. It may be associated with nystagmus. And good number of time, if nystagmus is associated with vertigo sensation, it is 100% in favor of a vestibular apparatus. The person gives you a typical description of rotatory feeling or spinning or tilting or swaying. And this may be peripheral or maybe because of central nervous system stimulation. So it is an illusion of self-movement. If there is an objective feeling that is surrounding is rotating, it is called oscillopsia or objective. If the person feels that he is rotating, it is called pulsion or subjective. being pulled in one direction. He feels that as if he is rotating. So true vertigo is basically an illusion or hallucination of movements. In both variety of vertigo, whether central or peripheral, there is a disequilibrium, and it involves the illusion of sense of movements. So we call central or peripheral. Central means damage to the brainstem or cerebellum, while peripheral is damage to labyrinth or vestibular nerve. We call vestibular neuritis or labyrinthitis, the two most common. And we divide the vertigo into two big groups. Subjective we call as a pulsant, and objective we call as a oscillopsia. Depending upon the symptoms, we call rotatory vertigo or a non-rotatory vertigo. Another description wise, subjective, objective, or we call pulsant and we call oscillopsia. If it is without any stimulus, we call it a spontaneous. If it is induced by a movement or rotation of the head, etc., then it is called as an induced vertigo. These are the different terms which are being utilized. So vestibular vertigo or a non-vestibular vertigo. Non-vestibular can be because of ocular problems or other. While vestibular, you can divide into peripheral and central. And sometimes there is a little element of both. We call it an intermediate variety. So the commonest causes of central vertigo is a CP angle tumor or cerebellopontine angle tumor, cerebrovascular disease. It can be part and partial along with a migraine. We call it a migrainous vertigo, or in a person with multiple sclerosis, which can involve brainstem or even cerebellum. And that will be one of the variety of what we call the degenerative disorder. While peripheral, the most common is acute labyrinthitis, BPPV, Meniere's disease. These three accounts for topmost conditions. Or another we call is a vestibular neuritis. So these are some of the conditions which will produce peripheral vertigo. Very rarely, perilymphatic fistula, otosclerosis, cholestatoma, etc. But the most common is BPPV, acute labyrinthitis, vestibular neuritis, and Meniere's. Very simple way to differentiate between the central and peripheral. In central, as it involves the brainstem and cerebellum, person can have an altered level of consciousness, which is never present in peripheral variety. The person with central will very commonly present with headache, seizures, nausea, vomiting, neurological symptoms and signs, maybe sensory symptom, maybe motor, maybe cranial nerve palsy, very, very common. And clinical evidence of raised intracranial pressure by means of severe headache, vomiting, blurred vision, and papilledema. While peripheral vertigo person will invariably present with only nausea, vomiting, maybe prostration, pallor, sweating, may have a local symptoms like tinnitus, hyperacusis, paraacusis, diplacusis, hearing disturbances, otalgia, may have a ear discharge, may have a tympanic membrane changes on local examination of tympanic membrane, etc. So now we are giving a difference between central and peripheral. Usually in a central vertigo, there is a latency less. It will be almost continuous. This is usually for 2 to 30 seconds. Duration is very less in peripheral. Very rarely it is for a longer period. While in central, it is always more than 30 seconds. The person will always complain of fatigability. Usually, vertigo will be a very, very common in peripheral, while maybe may not be a classical symptoms in case of a central. Habituation is very common with peripheral vertigo, and nystagmus will be very commonly bidirectional, or we call it a vertical or horizontal, while usually in a peripheral it is unidirectional, and very commonly it is a horizontal, very rarely rotatory. Onset in peripheral is usually sudden, while in central it is gradual and progressive. while in peripheral it is episodic or recurrent. Duration in central it is for weeks and months, while in peripheral it is for seconds and minutes. Nystagmus is very commonly in a peripheral horizontal variety, while in a central it will be vertical or rotatory. Peripheral vertigo will be stimulated by movements, while symptom may worse, but usually not triggered by movements. Peripheral will be very frequently associated with hearing disturbances, while in a central, very rarely it is with hearing disturbances, but very frequently it is associated with neurological symptoms and signs like seizures, cranial nerve palsy, motor weakness, sensory findings, cerebellar findings. Tympanic membrane examination will be good number of time abnormal. You can have retraction, inflammation, perforation, ear discharge. Ear discharge, otalgia, etc. Very, very common in peripheral variety. While tympanic membrane examination, external auditory canal, etc. will be absolutely normal. Person will very frequently complain of fatigue in peripheral, not in case of central. We already told you tinnitus, nausea, vomiting, hyperacusis, etc. is very common with peripheral. While neurological symptoms and visual symptom signs will be very common with central variety. Ataxia will be more common with central rather than peripheral variety. There are four common different groups as far as dizziness is concerned. That is vertigo, presyncope, ataxia, and light headache. Vertigo, the most common cause is BPPV, Meniere's, labyrinthitis. These three comes topmost on the list. While presyncope can be because of cardiac arrhythmias, structural heart disease, anemia, dehydration, hypoglycemia, etc., or even because of postural hypotension. Disequilibrium is very commonly because of sensory or because of vestibular or because of cerebellar ataxia. And light headache, which is very commonly because of what we call as psychogenic groups or because of drugs. Very, very common. Now, once you clinically suspect the person is having a vertigo, we go for a clinical assessment. And in a clinical assessment, whenever a person said that I am feeling dizzy, first question what we ask is, what do you mean by dizzy? If person doesn't understand and he's not clear, you can give a suggestive questions like, does room spin, or do you feel that you are spinning? Do you feel that your legs are becoming weak? Do you feel that you will stagger around while you are walking, or you are getting light headache, etc.? What we call is a suggestive questions. As far as possible, you try to get a good answer by putting all these questions. So if a person says that, I feel surrounding is spinning, it is straightforward in favor of vertigo. If he said that I might fall or I might lose balance while standing or while walking, it is more in favor of ataxia. And if he says that I'll faint or I'll become giddy, it is more in favor of presyncope. Or if he says that I get blackouts, then also it is in favor of presyncope. If a person says that I will either become dizzy or I'll faint, again it is in favor of what we call as a syncopal attacks. Or you have to give a suggestive questions like, do you feel rotating feelings or surrounding is rotating? If answer is yes, vertigo. If he says that he is unsteady on standing or on walking, ataxia. If he gives an answer that he is fainting or he is about to faint or there is a blackouts in front of the eye, presyncope. And if he has got an altered level of consciousness, it is definitely in favor of a syncope. So these are typical pictures showing you the person is having imbalance while standing, a person nearly becoming fainting episodes, he falls down and he is about to become unconscious near syncope, or he feels the surrounding is rotating, or he has got lot of other symptoms like headache, or he is not able to describe you properly. more in favor of psychiatric disorder. And if the person says that everything is rotating around like this, it is in favor of what type. So again, same thing shown here, four different groups. Syncope, you will have to differentiate orthostatic hypotension, cardiac arrhythmia, hypersensitive carotid sinus, vasovagal syncope, or maybe because of structural heart disease. This will be the common group which will come across in a syncope. While in an ataxia, cerebellar, sensory, or we call vestibular. Vestibular can also produce ataxia. And when you get a vertigo, you will have to differentiate between peripheral and central vertigo. Central is mainly because of the damage to what we call as a brainstem or to the cerebellum or vestibular nucleus and its connections. And when it does not fit with any one of these three, it is more in favor of a psychiatric disorders. And you will have to differentiate between anxiety, depression, and also don't forget to rule out drug induced, and sometimes it can be even idiopathic. So typical description, straightforward in favor of vertigo. Once clinically you suspect vertigo, try to confirm again it is vertigo or not and rule out other conditions we call as a non-vertigo dizziness. After making a diagnosis of vertigo, now you will have to differentiate between two groups, central and peripheral, and try to identify the etiology by clinical examination and by investigations. And then you decide regarding what treatment to be given. Because in central, very frequently they might require a surgical intervention depending upon the etiology. While in peripheral, usually it is very easily controlled by drugs. And in case of Meniere disease, may require surgical interventions. Usually this is one of the approach, what we call is a practical approach on vertigo. We call is a titrate. TI is for timings, TR is for triggering factors, and TE is for target examination. So while taking history, you have to take an onset, how it is continuing, what is the duration, etc., and it helps you to some extent. Triggering factor, provocating factor, or we call aggravating factor, and associated symptoms and signs gives you an idea regarding the central or peripheral, and also get a good history regarding the drugs, cardiovascular disease, etc. So timing wise, if it is recurrent and for a very short period, for few seconds only, it is BPPV. It is a single episode, acute onset, and lasts for days, more in favor of labyrinthitis or vestibular neuritis. And this is the most common cause for peripheral vertigo. While Meniere disease is usually recurrent, it lasts for hours, and usually it is in an old person, associated with a sensory hearing disturbances, etc. If it is associated with severe headache, migrainous variety of a headache, with vestibular symptoms and signs, it is in favor of a what we call as a vestibular migraine or vertebrobasilar migraine. In case of a brain infarct, it is a single episode or a recurrent episode, maybe lasting for several minutes to hours. And invariably in this particular condition, you will have a central symptoms and signs. That is neurological symptoms and signs in the form of a cranial nerve palsy or maybe cerebellar signs, motor weakness, sensory findings, etc. Triggering factor, if it is triggered by movements of head and neck in a particular direction, in a particular angle, BPPV. If it is after viral infections, more in favor of a labyrinthitis or vestibular neuritis. Labyrinthitis is very frequently associated with unilateral hearing disturbances. Meniere's disease is usually spontaneous, very frequently associated with a unilateral hearing disturbances, and mostly it is a neurological or we call as a nerve conduction deafness. We already mentioned that in a vestibular migraine there will be history of migraine. And brainstem, prior history of a stroke will be very, very common. And that will be associated with very frequently neurological symptoms and signs. Fistula may be associated with coughing, sneezing, and loud noise may precipitate the episode in a perilymphatic fistulas. As far as examination is concerned, vital signs like blood pressure in sitting and erect posture to rule out a postural hypotension. Look for tachycardia and irregular or severe bradycardia to rule out cardiac conditions which produces hypotension and can produce what we call as a syncopal episodes or presyncopes. We already told you cranial nerve palsy, sensory motor weakness, abnormal cerebellar signs, Romberg test positive, all goes in favor of what we call as a central causes. Cardiovascular system examination, murmur will go more in favor of a structural heart disease. Carotid bruit again will go in favor of a syncopal episodes. Ear examination, particularly Weber's test, Raine's test, abnormal will go in favor of a peripheral vertigo. Otoscopy showing you abnormal tympanic membrane or discharge otorrhea again goes in favor of peripheral. Dick's helpic maneuver, supine head roll test or Hinz examination will help you to differentiate peripheral from central vertigo. So tuning fork test and ear examination is very useful to rule out peripheral vertigo or to confirm peripheral vertigo. Cranial nerve involvement, sensory motor signs, cerebellar signs, etc. will be very important to rule out the central causes. Presence of nystagmus itself suggests more in favor of a peripheral vertigo. And if it is a horizontal nystagmus, more in favor of peripheral. Vertical or rotatory nystagmus goes more in favor of a central causes. Dick's helpic maneuver will tell you regarding BPPV. Also examine for the Romberg test, and there are modified tests for this balance, etc. And also examine for the gait. If gait is abnormal, it goes more in favor of ataxia, which can be vestibular, can be cerebellar, or can be vertebrobasilar, or we call vestibular. Ear examination, we have told you, if there is an evidence of a herpes in one side ear, it is more in favor of Ramsay-Hirt syndromes. And if there is a disturbances in Raine's test or a Weber test, it again goes in favor of a peripheral vertigo. No nystagmus, no hints in examination for you. But if nystagmus is present, there is no need to do Dick's helpic maneuver. Dick's helpic maneuver is very sensitive to diagnose BPPV, because if that is positive, it is more in favor of a BPPV. Nystagmus from Dick's helpic maneuver is very peculiar in a BPPV. So that also gives you an idea regarding a peripheral vertigo. Supine roll test is also helpful to confirm BPPV, which canal is involved, etc. You can make a diagnosis. There is something called as a Hinz examination, that is head impulse test is for HI, nystagmus, and then test for skew. This is very important in a case of a central vertigo. So you can examine for that particular purpose. Romberg test is also useful to find out ataxia, which can be cerebellar ataxia or sensory ataxia, or we call vestibular ataxia. You can go for a gait test, which will be very important again to find out ataxic group of syndromes. We already mentioned regarding Dick's helpic maneuver. There is something called as a Fukuda test, where you have to stand on one leg, and if a person can stand for more than 30 seconds, almost ataxia is ruled out. Tandem walking, finger nose test, these are all useful to rule out, we call as an incoordination, which is very commonly because of a cerebellar damage. There is something called as a head shaking test, finger nose test, fistula test, Romberg test, pass pointing test, or Berenice pass pointing test. It is called Utenberg stepping test, or it is also called, we have already shown you, called Fukuda test. This is also called as a Fukuda test. So you can go for a pass pointing test, Romberg test, Utenberg test, Utenberger test. This is pass pointing test, tandem walking. These are all to rule out different groups in ataxia, whether it is cerebellar. There's a little modification during Romberg test that is called gendrasic maneuver. You clench the fist by which you increase the tone in the muscle and try to do the Romberg test. If still it is positive, it goes in more in favor of ataxia, maybe what we call as sensory or maybe cerebellar. Babinski-Wales test, where you ask the person to walk front and back and look for abnormality. This goes in favor of ataxia. You can go for what we call as a Berenice pointing test, finger nose test. This is a finger nose test. This is Berenice pointing test. It will be very strongly positive in presence of cerebellar ataxia. Reinhart's test, Weber's test, caloric test may be also helpful. You can go for CT or MRI to rule out the central causes. ECG, cardiac monitoring, carotid Doppler, echocardiography, etc. for ruling out cardiac causes for syncope and presyncopes. You might have to even go for what we call as a Holter monitoring, ILR, external loop recorder, internal loop recorder, EP studies, etc. Audiometry will be very helpful to rule out a peripheral variety. All these are some of the tests which can help you to identify the cause. Electronystomography will help you to find out the presence of nystagmus, the variety of nystagmus, vestibular functions, whether it is there is a central damage or peripheral damage. Frenzel goggles may be also helpful to rule out the miscellaneous groups like hypoglycemia. Go for blood sugar test, pulse oximetry may be also helpful. Pregnancy test also may rule out other causes. ECG, echo for cardiac causes, MRI, CT, etc. to rule out the central causes. Audiometry to rule out the peripheral causes. Once you divide into four big groups, vertigo, presyncope, ataxia, and we call as a psychogenic groups. We call step one, step two, and step three. These are the investigations which are very commonly done in a vertigo, mainly Dick's helpic maneuver to rule out BPPV. Meniere's disease, labyrinthitis, CT scan to rule out the central causes. In a presyncope, mainly carotid sinus massage, loop recorder, tilt table test for particularly what we call as postural hypotension. Then stress test to find out whether there is any abnormality in the heart. Echo, loop recorder, EPS study, all those are necessary to rule out the cardiac conditions. For what we call as the ataxia group, good CNS examination followed by CT, MRI, etc. will be useful. And in a case of a psychiatric group, good clinical examination followed by a psychiatric examination will be helpful. Now, when you want to differentiate an approach for a vertigo groups, first you will have to find out whether it is a true vertigo or not. So you differentiate true vertigo from a non-vertigo groups. In a true vertigo, you will have to differentiate between a central and peripheral. I already mentioned. Mainly, you will have to differentiate BPPV, Meniere's, vestibular neuritis, and labyrinthitis. BPPV will be related with position. In only one particular position, person will get vertigo, which will be lasting for few seconds only. Mainly for 10 to 15 seconds. In Meniere's, the person will have a hearing disturbances, mainly sensory loss, and there will be associated symptoms like tinnitus or oral fullness, gradually progressive, more in old age groups. Vestibular neuritis will be very commonly following a URTI. So if a prior history of URTI and then followed by a vertigo, more goes in favor of a vestibular neuritis. And bacterial labyrinthitis, very frequently there will be abnormality in the tympanic membrane. Person might have a ear discharge, otalgia, etc. And may be associated with even a hearing disturbances, particularly conductive disturbances. And non-vertigo groups, mainly you should rule out what we call as cardiovascular groups, particularly for ruling out presyncope groups like cardiac arrhythmias, structural heart disease, orthostatic hypotension, etc. Also, you should look for what we call as a vasovagal and also for carotid sinus sensitivity. So try to rule out those particular conditions. And don't forget what we call as a drug-induced and psychogenic groups. So this is a very useful slide. If clinical you are suspecting vertigo, go for a good history and physical examination. Very simple thing, blood pressure. If there is a fall of blood pressure in an erect posture, more than 20 millimeters straightforward, it goes in favor of orthostatic hypotension. And then you can go for further investigation for orthostatic hypotension like drugs, diabetes mellitus, autonomic dysfunction, etc., and treat accordingly. Look at the pulse. If pulse is absolutely irregular, or it is irregularly irregular, there is severe bradycardia or severe tachycardia, go for cardiac arrhythmias group. Have a good neurological examination. If there is any abnormality in a neurological examination, it is more in favor of a central causes. So go for CT scan, MRI scan, PET scan, etc. If there is a history of trauma, go for benign positional BPPV, which the person will give you a typical history. That person is having a vertigo in a particular angle while movements. If there is a history of recent viral infection, particularly viral URTI, it goes in favor of a viral labyrinthitis. If there is a history of drug, antibiotics, diuretic, or some chemotherapy, etc., toxic labyrinthitis. If there is a history of trauma, you will have to rule out traumatic injury to the vestibular apparatus. If there is a hearing disturbances, consult ENT specialist, have a good audiometry, rule out Meniere's disease, toxic labyrinthitis, or acoustic neuroma, central causes, etc. So this is a very, very good slide which almost helps you to differentiate the common causes of dizziness right from vertigo, postural hypotension, cardiac arrhythmias, BPPV, labyrinthitis, etc. And this is the same way it is given, that if the person has got episodic vertigo or a continuous vertigo, so in an episodic, you try to rule out BPPV, orthostatic hypotension, Meniere's disease, vestibular migraine, or psychiatric groups. While in a continuous variety, because of a barotrauma, or because of vestibular neuritis, or because of central causes. At your leisure time, you can go through. This is again a similar slide shown where altered level of consciousness, true vertigo, central causes, vertigo with sudden onset of by movements, with hearing disturbances, with tinnitus, etc., how you approach, that is being given. At your leisure time, you can go through whatever we have mentioned before is again repeated here. With vertigo, if the person is having a migraine attacks, it is migraineous vertigo. If a person is having a hearing disturbances, it will be more in favor of a Meniere's. If there is a constant vertigo, more in favor of labyrinthitis. And if there is no hearing disturbance, then it may be BPPV. And Dick's helpic maneuver will prove it. Or if it is a constant and there is no hearing disturbances, more in favor of pure simple vestibular. neuronitis. Now, one of the very close, sometimes we do mistake it that as a vertigo, or we miss this particular condition, we call it a temporary loss of consciousness. If there is no temporary loss of consciousness, we don't have to go through this picture. Whenever there is a temporary loss of consciousness, always suspect syncope, and we call as a non-syncopal episodes, which produces temporary loss of consciousness like seizures, psychogenic, or rare groups. In a syncope, we'll come across some of the groups. We'll show you a slide further. So, non-traumatic causes, usually we will have to go through non-traumatic groups of temporary losses. We'll be showing you that further slide. And if there's a traumatic head trauma following a temporary loss, at the maximum we can go for a CT or MRI to rule out internal damage. By and large, if it is temporary, it is, we call it a concussion. Now, if there is no history of trauma, then you have to search for syncope, epileptic seizures, psychogenic groups, and rare groups like subclavian steel syndrome, vertebrobasilar artery TIA, subarachnoid hemorrhage, cyanotic spells in small children, etc. These are absolutely rare groups, very, very rare. Psychogenic group, one of the very common groups. You should try to differentiate where it will be ideally not a temporary loss of consciousness. You will have to differentiate that between a true syncope and epilepsy. Very easy to differentiate. We will have one slide to differentiate between the two. But at this particular time, I will give you a little idea. The person will become unconscious. He will have a stage of aura followed by a tonic-clonic phase, postictal phase, which will not be seen in a classical syncope. Person will have a tongue bite, involuntary bladder and bowel movements, vomiting, aspiration, external injuries. Good number of things will be present. Very easy to identify epileptic seizures from syncope. And for syncope, you will have to differentiate the three big groups. We call orthostatic hypotension, cardiac arrhythmia, and structural heart disease. Structural heart disease can be easily differentiated by doing an echocardiography and by clinical examination, presence of murmur, etc. Cardiac arrhythmia by ECG or by Holter monitoring or by external loop recorder, internal loop recorder, or by EPS study. And these are some of the causes of syncope. And this particular is a very simple to identify by measuring a blood pressure in supine and measuring the blood pressure in erect posture. Fall more than 20 millimeter goes straight forward in favor of orthostatic hypotension. And from these three groups, you will have to differentiate one more group we call as a vasovagal, which can be vasovagal, which can be situational, very easy from history. Vasovagal will be very common in a person who is having a prolonged standing, prolonged erect posture, working in a sunlights, and person will have a dehydrated person can develop vasovagal. And there is one more condition we call as a carotid sinus hypersensitivity. That sometimes very easy to differentiate by doing carotid sinus massage, etc. So this is big group. Neurally mediated is almost 24%. By these three groups, if you combine together, it is also more than 30%. Unknown etiology or idiopathic is almost accounting for 35%. While non-cardiovascular, non-neurally mediated is accounting for only 12%. So this together is accounting for 30 to 35%. This is 30 to 35%. This is 25%, and psychogenic is accounting for 10 to 12%. These are called syncope mimics. The person mimics like syncope, but person do not have impaired level of consciousness, like falls, drop attacks, cataplexy, which is a in a psychiatric group of disorders, And there are some disorders with loss of consciousness like epilepsy, we already mentioned. Metabolic disorders like hypoglycemia, hyper or hyponatremia, or TIA involving vertebrobasilar territory, VB territory, TIA, etc. Whenever you suspect a syncope, and if a person is having these signs, we call red flag sign, if you see this type of people. Now, syncope with injury, syncope during exercise, syncope in supine position, very rare, absolutely rare, but still if you see once in a while, it is a very dangerous condition. Syncope with structural heart disease, ECG showing you WPW, long QT, bundle branch block, severe bradycardia, multiple pauses, sinus arrest, sick sinus syndrome, advanced heart block, severe tachyarrhythmias, myocard infarctions, family history of sudden cardiac death, or on an ECG you see a short QT, long QT, ARVD, etc. Frequent episodes, more than two in a year, or person is already on pacemaker or defibrillators, all these are bad signs and in a high risk groups. Always look for red flag signs. Like advanced age also, it is dangerous. And whenever you suspect syncope and you are not able to clinically identify or by some of the investigation, very simple way of approach. Good clinical history, first is ECG. Echocardiography to rule out structural heart disease. If structural heart disease and echocardiography and ECG does not show you any evidence, straightforward you can go for what we call the tilt table test, carotid sinus massage and Valsalva maneuver to find out vasovagal or we call it the carotid sensitive sinus, carotid sinus hypersensitivity, try to rule out that cause. If there is any evidence of structural heart disease or ECG is showing any abnormality, 24 hours monitoring, ambulatory monitoring, or we call the Holter monitoring, exercise testing, EP study, internal loop recorder, external loop recorder, etc. If on this, if you can't make a diagnosis, again go for tilt table test, carotid sensitive massage, carotid sinus massage, Valsalva maneuver, etc. and try to find out the other groups. Same thing shown here. You can have an ENT evaluation, you can have an endocrine evaluation, you can go for a syncope workup like Holter, ELR, tilt table test, ECHO, EPS study, or you can try to rule out a central causes with CT, carotid Doppler, MRI, brain scan, EEG to rule out epilepsy. And some of the odd tests which requires to rule out the cardiac causes like angiogram, exercise testing, or stress-induced conditions. This disease, already I've made a discussion between syncope and seizures, that usually in seizures you will have different stages like we call as an aura followed by a tonic-clonic phase. Then you can have cyanosis. You can have involuntary maturation, involuntary defecations, epileptic cry, tongue bite, external injury, etc. Urinary incontinence, tongue bite, those will be very, very common. Postictal phase will be common, which is not commonly seen with a syncope. In a syncope, you will get some cardiovascular finding, which is quite common. EEG will be abnormal in case of a seizures. I've already mentioned regarding ataxia that person will say that I am about to fall when I'm walking, or I'm swaying while walking. I cannot maintain my balance. It is usually very nicely identified when person has got symptoms while walking. Invariably, they will have neurological symptoms and signs, examination finding, cerebellar finding, etc. very frequently in ataxia groups. And there are three common variety of ataxia: cerebellar, vestibular, and sensory. We don't go into detail regarding the examination of CNS. We will have CNS findings. Now I'm going into little detail regarding the three common groups in a vertigo. We call it a BPPV, which is a rotational vertigo. It is in a head movements in a particular direction. It is mainly for few seconds. It does not last for more than 30 seconds. So if any vertigo which is lasting for more than few minutes and hours, it is less likely to be BPPV. There is a no hearing disturbance. There is no neurological symptoms and signs. So these two things is very important. So head position, duration, and no hearing disturbance and no neurological symptoms and signs gives you a very good answer regarding a BPPV. Good number of time person will give you a history of a ear trauma or because of ear infection prior to this. And Dick's helping maneuver, while doing that, it will give you an idea regarding which semicircular canal is being involved. Also, there will be abnormal caloric test good number of time. So you can have abnormal caloric test, and Dick's helping maneuver will give you an idea. While very important finding we already mentioned before, that there will be no neurological symptoms and signs. Very, very useful. So look at this, all these findings will tell you the answer regarding BPPV. This is a Dick's helping maneuver. If you don't know how to do it, don't try to do it at all. In a Meniere's disease, along with vertigo, long duration of symptoms, gradually progressive, recurrent episodes, old individual, very frequently tinnitus, there is a conductive neurological deafness, now conduction deafness, and there is a hearing loss. The person will have mainly disturbances in what we call as a homeostasis around the inner ear. So the treatment is different in Meniere's disease. Classical triad we call as vertigo, fluctuation in hearing loss, and tinnitus. So when these three things are together, it is straightforward, more in favor of Meniere's. I'll add one more. Usually it is in old age, not in a younger age groups. So this is the difference between vestibular BPPV, Meniere's, and perilymphatic fistula. So vestibular neuritis, duration is for days, associated with nausea, vomiting very commonly. There may be peripheral nystagmus, usually horizontal nystagmus, and with change in head position. BPPV, it is for less than 30 seconds. It is because of particular position. There is no conductive deafness, no neurological signs, symptoms and signs. You can have a history of trauma. In a Meniere's, it is by and large good number of time unilateral, tinnitus, hearing loss, gradually increasing in an old individual. We rarely see this perilymphatic fistula. This is again a difference between BPPV, Meniere's. Here two more causes are added, psychogenic and central vertigo. Important part, in a central vertigo, you will have always neurological symptoms and signs. While in psychogenic, more commonly they will be hyperventilating. So that will be there. In a BPPV, mainly maneuver will be very helpful. In a Meniere's, restricted, salt-restricted diet, diuretics, vestibular suppression or surgical intervention. In a psychogenic, anti-anxiety, anti-depression drugs. While for central, you will require investigation and treat according to the etiology. Same thing what we have mentioned before, that is mentioned here. In a BPPV, different maneuver like Epley maneuver or Deroff maneuver or Dick's helping maneuver will be helpful. In labyrinthitis, vestibular rehabilitation. In Meniere's, we already mentioned low salt diet, diuretic, surgical intervention, sometime even injection of gentamicin into those semicircular canals. In a infected labyrinthitis, antibiotics, vestibular rehabilitation. In vestibular neuritis, steroid may be of some help, and again vestibular rehabilitation. In a migraine, beta blockers, CCB will be helpful. In TIA, antiplatelet drugs. In CP angle tumor, surgical removal. So we have already mentioned regarding all this in previous slides. We have mentioned in BPPV, Apley manure you can go for. You can go for this brand Darof manure. There is another manure called as a rollover manure, or also called as a Lampert manure. Lampert manure is also effective. In a vestibular neuritis, we have told you that glucocorticoids or steroids can be helpful, but should be used with precautions. By and large, in a vestibular neuritis, you can utilize antiemetics. Flochlorperazine is better than metoclopramide. Among antihistaminic, meclizine is much better than dimenhydramine and flomethazine. Or sometimes you can use also benzodiazepine like diazepam or lorazepam. But side effect of this is sedation. All this will produce sedation, but sedation will be more with diazepam and lorazepam. So don't try to use in a person who is having activity like working with sharp instruments, drivers, etc. These are the different doses of meclizine, dihydraminate, diazepam, lorazepam, metachlorpropamide, prochlorperazine, promethazine, etc. At your leisure time, you can go through all those doses. I'm not going in detail. This is one useful slide where you can use calcium antagonist, flunarizine or cinnarizine. There is one vasodilator, that is beta-histidine, tranquilizer like diazepam, or antihistaminic like meclizine, out of which calcium antagonist, tranquilizer and antihistaminics, they produce little sedation. So whenever you don't want any sedative effect, you can use any one of these three groups, A, C and D. But you don't want sedation, based is beta-histidine. Depending upon the condition, you can utilize that. All are effective. All are effective. Only advantage of beta-histidine is non-sedative. And being non-sedative, in an active worker, the person who are working in factory, who are working with heavy instruments, person who are traveling or who are driving cars, scooters, etc., you should be with caution. You should use those drugs with caution. So I end my lecture here. I'll be talking on cases, discussion, etc. in subsequent lecture, that is live webinar on Wednesday. And I hope this lecture will be very useful, because you will see these particular groups. You should differentiate vestibular from non-vertigo causes of dizziness, and particularly syncope, you should be able to differentiate.